Tone K. A. Play A. Well, good morning. I invite you all to stand up this morning as we begin to worship the Lord in song. And let's remember to pray for one another. As you can see, Kelly's not here. She's a little under the weather, but continue to pray for Kelly. But we got pastors going to help us out this morning in the drums. So we got a little special treat today.
Seated this morning.
For more than 60 years, Nazarenes around the world have been sacrificing financially to construct hospitals, schools, churches, and homes for missionaries through what is known as Alabaster Offering. But gifts to the Alabaster Offering provide much more than buildings. When you give to the Alabaster Offering, you are teaching children to read and write. You are meeting healthcare needs where common illnesses claim lives. You are uniting with believers of different cultures as the global church. You are housing missionaries so they can share the good news of Jesus. Your gift to the Alabaster Offering is a gift of hope to thousands in every corner of the world because you choose to pour out the love God has lavished on you.
Well, isn't it great to be in God's house this morning? I tell you what, it's a huge blessing to be able to worship freely without having to worry about being persecuted. And last week we finished the series, Blessed Are Those Who Are Persecuted. And it's just a reminder to all of us, I think a great reminder for us, that we enjoy a freedom that is not found in other places in the world. And so we are so thankful to God for that. And I want to just follow up with that video that we just watched. Next week is our Alabaster Sunday, and we want to encourage you, if you've not picked up your Alabaster box that's in the foyer, this is what they look like, just a little box to collect your Alabaster offering. You can put your extra change in there, you can put checks, cash in there, and then next week we'll be actually collecting our Alabaster offering, and that money goes to help build churches and schools and hospitals and all kinds of pastors' homes around the world. And so this is our opportunity to collect those funds, and people around the world collect that Alabaster offering to help to build those and take care of meeting the needs spiritually and also physically as well. So I want to encourage you to get your Alabaster box and bring that thing full for next Sunday. We'll be collecting that Alabaster offering. Then also, just a couple of quick things. I wanted to encourage you, if you are new here today, we're glad that you are here, and we want to ask if you'll take this connection card in the seat pocket in front of you, and you'll if you'll put your information on there, just put your name, your address, your just fill out all that information. Make sure that you put your Social Security number and your credit. No, I'm joking. I'm joking, okay? We don't want that information, just make sure you fill that out and place that. There's a tithe and offering box over here on the side, and I want to encourage you to place that in that box, or you can hand it personally to me or someone at the Welcome Center, and that will get back to me. Also, on the back of that card is a place for you to share maybe a prayer request that you have. Life is hard, and we know that God is really good. And so we believe that God answers prayer, and in fact, many of us here around this room could say, you know what, I have answers to prayer. I can testify how God has answered prayer. We want to give you an opportunity to share whatever prayer requests you might have and give us an opportunity to partner with you in prayer about the things that you're going through. There's something special about being a part of the family of God and being able to be lifting each other up in prayer. And I just want to encourage you to utilize that as a great resource to communicate your requests. Also, we have another card in that pew pocket there, or pew pocket, chair, the pockets in the back of the chairs. And that's called an encouragement card. I hope that you'll use that. If you look around and go, you know what, I see somebody's not here this morning. You know what, I think they might need a little bit of encouragement. I can promise you that I have not had one person come to me and say, I am done with being encouraged. Quit it. Quit sending those cards. I love getting them too. So I just want to encourage you to encourage others. Grab that encouragement card. Fill that out. If you'll put the name, if they're a person here, put their name on the front there, and we'll address it. If you wonder, well, I don't know if they'll have that address, put that address on there for us, and then we'll make sure that it gets sent. And that's a great way to encourage others. Also, we've got some big activities coming up. We want to encourage you to be looking at your bulletin and stay on top of the things that are coming up. There's men's ministries, there's women's ministry activities. One thing that's kind of unique, I would say, I don't think I've ever done this at any other church I've ever been a part of, okay, is our men's skeet and meat event. Most of the churches that I've served, we would have had the police show up if we were shooting skeet on the church property. This congregation and this family of believers, we enjoy getting together. Our men have a great time, and they enjoy shooting some skeet and eating some great barbecue meat. So I want to encourage our men to participate in that. Grab an extra invitation card. Use those as a way of inviting your friends to be a part of that exciting time. And I know our women also have really good activities and events too. Just keep track in your bulletin there. I think there's a luncheon, a women's luncheon coming up. So this Saturday, thank you, that's coming up. Want to encourage you to be a participant in those. I just encourage you to invite your friends. That's what is important. You know, there may be people in your life or people that you don't even know that that don't know Jesus. And it's important for us to give them something that's more important than a job, to give them something that's more important than anything that this world will ever give, and that's to give them Jesus. So let's do what we can to encourage people in pursuing Jesus, because he certainly is pursuing us. And so we thank him for that. Would you just stand for a moment and find about four or five people better looking than yourself and shake their hands and tell them that you're glad that they're here today. Hey, I like that. It's looking good. Yeah. Hey, Kim.
Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Amen. Aren't you glad for Jesus this morning? Aren't you thankful this morning that He loves us so very much today? He knows where we're at. He knows what we're walking through. He knows what's troubling us. And this morning, we want to just invite you to come and find a place around the altar or around the front or one of the front seats and just spend a little bit of time with Him this morning. You know, He is worthy of our praise this morning. Amen. He's worthy to be honored this morning. So this morning, as they continue to play, would you come and find a place this morning and just spend a little bit of time with the Lord this morning? Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. precious Heavenly Father, thank you this morning. Thank you for your love. Thank you that while we were yet sinners, Christ died so that we might have life and life more abundantly. And Lord, we thank you this morning that you know exactly where each one is at today. Father God, you know exactly what each one is going through. Lord, you know exactly the attack that each one is facing. And Lord, we're thankful today that we can say you're more than enough for that. Lord, you're more than enough to take care of your children. You're more than enough to meet our financial needs, our spiritual needs, our physical needs. And Lord, we thank you for that today. That we serve a Father who loves us genuinely, even when we fail. Even when we mess up, Lord, you, the Father, run to us, your children, as we come to repent, as we come to say, I'm sorry. Lord, thank you for that, for your unconditional love, for your grace that overwhelms us so many times because we're not worthy of it. But Lord, we thank you today for that. Thank you, Lord, that you care about the things that concern us, the things that are going on in our lives. And Lord, we know that the enemy is out to steal, kill, and destroy today. The enemy is out to bring confusion. The enemy is out to destroy families. But Lord, we know today that you are fighting for us. Lord, we know today that you are on our side. And your word says that if God be for us, then who can be against us? And Lord, we thank you for that today. Even though the world may rise up, even though troubles may rise up, even though storms may rise up, Lord, you're there to walk us through those storms. You're there to minister to us as we walk through our times of grief and our time of sorrow. And Lord, we thank you for that today. Lord, we thank you that you've called us and given us an opportunity to follow you, to be your disciple, to learn from you. And I ask that you would help each of us today to understand and realize today that, Father God, it's not an easy task. If it was easy, everyone would be doing it. But Lord, we thank you today for that opportunity to become more like you, to fix our hope upon you, and to take our lives and place our lives in your hands and say, Lord, this is your life. Do what you wish to do with it. Lord, we thank you for that today. We just thank you today for loving us and caring for us. We just ask that you would lead and guide and direct this service today, that your Holy Spirit would overwhelm us with your love. We ask it all in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Well, we are extremely blessed this morning. Do you feel blessed today? I hope you do. I tell you what, God has just poured out his blessings upon every one of us. And we have a lot of things to be grateful for, a lot of things to thank God for, because he is so good and he cares. He cares about us. He has our best interest in mind, and I'm grateful for that. Even through the hard times, he still has our best interest in mind. Let that sink in a little bit. You ever been through a hard time? You're probably going, man, I'm there. I'm going there now. You know, all of us, if we're honest, we've gone through hard times. And you know what? This isn't the end of hard times. We're going to go through hard times in the future too. But I tell you what, God isn't going to, he's not going to let us go. He's not going to let go of us. We may let go of him, but he's not going to let go. And so I'm just excited. I tell you what, we have a few children with us this morning. I want to invite them to come up here with me because I need them up here with me for a moment. So if you're a child up through the age of sixth grade, I'm sorry. If you're over sixth grade, I mean, you're no longer a child. But come on up here. Those of you that are here this morning, I just want to kind of talk with you a little bit about something that we're going to talk more of in the service. Hey, buddy, come on up here. Awesome. Man, I tell you what, these are a great group of kids. And I'm so excited that they are here. I'm so excited you all are here. You got a little sun there. You went out in the sun yesterday? It was a beautiful day. Did you get to play or? Oh, in the pool for 7 hours. That's what I'm talking about on a hot day. That is cool. I want to ask you all, did you know, and I know you probably know a lot of things, so I think you probably know this, but I just want to make sure. Do you know that God has a plan for you? Yeah? Does everybody know that? You know that, Levi? Okay, just making sure. Okay. God has a plan for you. And he has a plan not to harm you, not to hurt you. And sometimes we go through things, we feel pretty hurt. But God has a plan in the midst of all of that. And sometimes that's hard to understand when we go through hard times. And I'm sure some of you have gone through hard times. How many of you have gone through hard times? Oh, yeah, man, I tell you what, man, we have all gone through difficult times. And I want to ask you a question. You know, the disciples of Jesus, they went through hard times. Jesus, the Son of God, can you imagine? He went through hard times too. Imagine that. I mean, he didn't get a get-out-of-jail-free card. I mean, he had to go through pain too. I want to ask you a question. What do you think a disciple of Jesus looks like? Just kind of what do they look like? Do you know? Yes. Clean? They look clean? Okay. All right. Anybody else? Yes. They look happy? Okay. You think a disciple always looks happy? No, not always. But sometimes they do. Okay. What else? What do they look like? Do they wear clothes like I do? No. Disciples don't. Okay. Okay, not wearing the right clothes. So I brought some helps here, just real quick, because and these are special. They're kind of in my office, and I just thought I would kind of bring them out. I thought I'd ask. This is a bust. I don't know if you guys have anything like this in your room or not, but a Phineas Brzee. Everybody knows who Phineas Brzee is, right? Yeah, I mean, do you guys know who Phineas Brzee is? No. Do you think he is a disciple of Jesus? Does he look like one? No. Oh. You know, Phineas Brzee actually was a part of founding the Church of the Nazarene. I'm not going to go into a lot of the history of the church today with this lesson, but I brought another one. This I got when I got ordained from the Southern Nazarene University. This is John Wesley. Does he look like a disciple of Jesus? George Washington. All right. George Washington. Okay. Yeah, I don't know. He's got kind of bigger nose than George. Do you think he could be a disciple of Jesus? No. Okay. All right. So, you know, I like to watch police shows, and you know, when somebody gets convicted of something, they put them in a lineup. I thought this might be helpful for us to identify a disciple of Jesus. So can we get that first slide on the screen there? Do those guys look like disciples? Yes. They must be disciples. Why do you think? Why do you think? You think all three of them are? Maybe? No. Yes? Okay, what makes you think those guys look like disciples? Any thoughts? They just look like them. Okay? Anybody else? Any reason why you think these guys might? Yes. their clothes. They had the long robes, okay? And, okay, anything else? What's that? You have a picture of Jesus. That's great. In your Bible. That's very good. Okay, let's go to that next slide. I got some more pictures. What about these guys? Do they look like disciples of Jesus? No. Oh, no? One of them might? You think? Maybe? What? Yeah? The first and second one might be a disciple of Jesus? Okay? The one from this side? The guy with the glasses and the... They might. Okay? Okay? You see that? Say the guy that's one on the far right might be a disciple. Okay, let's go to that next slide. What about these three? Do you think they could? No, disciples of Jesus. All right. Why do you think that? You think they're hiding something? Look in those eyes. Look in the eyes. Okay, they might be hiding. Yeah. What else? Anything? They just don't look like disciples of Jesus. Oh, wait. He said they might be a disciple of Jesus on the inside. Ooh. Good observation. Okay. So let's go to that next slide. I pulled up some information on the definition of a disciple. And this is what I pulled. The term disciples, you probably already know this, but it's over 269 times in the New Testament that the Bible talks about disciples. Brings a reference. A disciple is a learner, a pupil. You know what a pupil is? Not the middle of your eye? No, not the middle of your eye. A pupil is a student. Are there any students here? Oh, so you mean you might be a disciple? Really? Wow. A learner, a pupil, a follower of a teacher, or a master, a follower of a... Do you have teachers in your classrooms? Not so here. Okay. Oh, also here. Also here. Okay. Yeah, make sure I get that right. Okay, a follower of a teacher, a master, imitators of their teachers. So are teachers only at school? No, you said we have teachers here. Do we have teachers anywhere else? Yes. Wait a minute, man. Let's think about this for a minute. Are there any teachers of school in here? We've got some teachers here. There's one over there. There's some over here. We have teachers. Hey, and they're teaching us things that we need to learn, right? And we're learners. Who else could be a teacher? Is it just teachers that are teachers? Who else could be a teacher? Anybody taught you something? I could be a teacher, yes. Who's that? Miss Linda. She's a teacher. Okay. What about at your home? Is there anybody that teaches you anything? What? Your parents or your guardians or your neighbors? What about your friends? Do your friends ever teach you anything? Sometimes. Yeah, you're like, man, our friends teach us all kinds of things. No. So your parents teach you. That's great. And you know, hopefully they're teaching you great things of God and exciting things there. Well, we're going to learn some more about disciples. And I think we've kind of figured out, I love your observation earlier, that there could be a disciple inside. And every one of us, every one of those people on the screen could have been a disciple and can be, and every one of you and me and everyone in this room could be a disciple. I want to go ahead and give you a chance to go back and sit with your parents. Thank you for helping me. Everybody give them a hand. They did a good job. Okay. So I'll put my bust of John Wesley back now that it has been called George Washington. Poor guy. Okay. Well, we're starting a new series. And there's a guy by the name of Kyle Eidelman. He's written a book called Not a Fan. If you haven't read it, I would encourage you to read it. But he is going to come, or not literally. We're going to watch a quick video clip. This book he's written is called Not a Fan, and it's about following Jesus, and we're talking about being a follower of Jesus. He has some really good things that were appropriate for the lesson today, so let's take a look at what he has to share.
A fan is simply defined as an enthusiastic admirer. I would have to say that for most of my Christian life, I haven't been much more than a fan of Jesus. I was born into a Christian home. I went to a Christian school. You know, my dad was a preacher, and from the beginning, I was expected to love Jesus. I was expected to believe in Jesus. And that meant by the time I was 13, you know, I was expected to have the Baptist blow-dry haircut. You know, the peer pressure that I experienced as a kid was to, you know, wear the Christian t-shirt. So I had God's Gym, I wore that one. This Blood's for You, yeah, I had that one too. And from the beginning, I was a fan. I was a fan of Jesus. In fact, in my room, this is true, in my room, next to a poster of Michael Jordan, I had a picture of Jesus Christ. And that kind of captures it. I mean, I was a fan of Michael and I was a fan of Jesus. I wanted to be like Jesus, but I wanted to be like Mike. And I thought that was enough. And what I've discovered over the years is that there are just a lot of Christians who are enthusiastic admirers of Jesus. They're fans. But then if you read through the Gospels, you discover that Jesus was never too interested in having fans. What he wanted was followers. He wasn't so concerned about the size of the crowd that was with him. He cared about the commitment of the people who were following him. You know, there's a passage of scripture that doesn't often get quoted, and it comes from Luke chapter 9, verse 23. It's Jesus, and he says, "If anyone wants to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." You know, for a lot of people, that invitation to follow Jesus by denying yourself and taking up your cross, oftentimes that isn't included in the presentation of the gospel. And they got the John 3:16, but the Luke 9:23 somehow got left out. But here's what I have discovered, that for me and for others on this journey, that it's not enough just to be a fan. That until you completely surrender your life to Jesus Christ, and until you give him every part of you, you'll never experience the real life, the true life that he wants you to have. And so you're going to hear some different stories of people on this website who have gone from being a fan of Jesus, just an enthusiastic admirer, to being a follower of Jesus. And they have said, "I'm ready to surrender. I'm ready to hold nothing back and to give everything I have to Jesus Christ." I don't know if you're a fan. Maybe you're someone, though, like me, who wanted to be close enough to Jesus to get all the benefits, but not so close that it required sacrifice. You wanted to follow Jesus into heaven, but you didn't necessarily want to take a cross with you. But the only invitation that Jesus offered was an invitation to die to yourself and to find life in him. When we move from being a fan, just an enthusiastic admirer, to being a follower of Jesus Christ, that's when we truly find the life that he wants us to have. My name is Kyle Eidelman, and I am not a fan.
Well, are you a fan or a follower? I hope and pray that you would say, you know what, I'm a follower of Jesus. You know, I'm not just a fan. I don't just admire him. I follow him. I am willing to take the heat when things get rough. And we're going to be in this series leading up to Advent season, and we're going to be talking about Jesus' teachings and when it comes to what it means to be his disciple or his follower. And so the title of our series is called, Who Am I? And we're going to, everybody say, Who Am I? And we're going to take a look at who we are in Christ. And then the next question is, who were they? Everybody say, who were they? And we're going to talk a little bit about the disciples. We want to take a look into their lives. What were they like? What kind of people were they? And what were they all about? How did they become disciples? We're going to look at that. And then the next question is, what now? Everybody say, what now? And we want to know, what are we supposed to do with all this? You know, as Christians, a follower of Jesus, a disciple of Jesus, what am I supposed to be doing? What is my job? What should be most important to me? How can I more appropriately align myself with the way that God created me to be? What is God's expectation of me? Does anybody ever ask those questions? You know, what does God want from me? You know, what does he desire of me? So throughout this series, we're going to be asking ourselves these questions and taking a look at what God has to say about them. This morning, our text can be found in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, and Matthew chapter 8, verse 18 through 22. I would invite you to please stand out of reverence for God's word. It's his word, and these passages are found towards the end of the Sermon on the Mount. And so we're going to take a look at them and ask the Lord what they have for us this morning. If you would just follow along, Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, and then chapter 8, verse 18 through 22, that should be on the screen, and or if you have it in your Bibles or your Bible apps. Follow along as I read. Matthew 7, 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. And then Matthew 8, chapter 18 through, or verse, chapter 8, verse 18 through 22. And when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave a command to depart to the other side. Then a certain scribe came and said to him, Teacher, I will follow you wherever you go. And Jesus said to him, Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And then another of his disciples said to him, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. But Jesus said to him, Follow me and let the dead bury their own dead. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, as we come before you, we're grateful for your word. And we're thankful that we can read it and apply it and ask questions about it and allow it to change us and draw us closer to you. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to get a little bit of a window, a view of how you would have us to live and be. Lord, just bless the remainder of our time together. Speak to our hearts, soften our hearts that we may hear all that you have for us today. Fill us up by the power of your Holy Spirit. We love you and pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, God's word reminds us as we begin to look at being at what it means to be a follower of Jesus, and I would actually prefer to call it a follower of Jesus more than a Christian. How many people have you come across in your lifetime that have said, "Hey, I'm a Christian," and a lot of people, right? And not all of them are really you see a different kind of attitude, a different action sometimes coming from them, and you go, man, you know, is that what a Christian's supposed to look like? And we sometimes are bad about judging, aren't we? Let's be honest. Okay, we judge people. Am I the only one that judges people? Oh, because you were making me really nervous for a minute. We judge people sometimes. I was talking with a friend of mine and an officer, and they said, you know what? I judge people. And I said, well, you know, you can always be willing to be to learn more about that person before you make a judgment call. And I said, I appreciate your honesty. And the truth is, we need to be honest. There are, sometimes we are horrible judges of other people and need to be honest with God and honest with others. And remember to be humble when we come, especially to the Lord, and let Him really be the true judge. Let's let God be the judge. His word, God's word says, they will know that we are Christians by our love for one another. And people out in the world, they're not going to see us as Christians if we're not learning how to love each other. You know, that is something that's important for us as Christians, those who call ourselves followers of Jesus. Many times he got tired. Jesus got tired, and he would look at them with compassion. He would look at them with love, and he would do things that he was probably ready to go lay down and take a nap and take a rest, but he would continue going because of his love. He was driven by his love. And aren't you thankful that Jesus was driven by love? That God, the Father, was driven by love to send his one and only Son. That is exciting, and that's the reason why we can be here and celebrate Jesus today. There's several things that we can learn from the Word of God, and I'd like for us to take a look at those. The first thing is there on your screen, is that a follower of Jesus is a person who chooses to live in the will of God. Who chooses to live in the will of God. Now, you're probably going, Pastor Nate, that is very vague. Yes, it is. Because if I said, let me give you a cookie-cutter approach to being a disciple of Jesus, I would fail miserably. Aren't you glad that Jesus can't be put in a box? Okay? That he sees the Father, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit sees potential in every single one of us. And that there is more going on than meets the eye. A follower of Jesus chooses to live in the will of God. You see, Jesus followed his Father. He did what his Father asked. So how do we know what the will of God is? I've been asked that many times. When I was doing youth ministry, I would have teens come to me. They're getting ready to graduate, and I'd ask them. I said, so what are you planning to do with the rest of your life? And they'd go, boy, I don't know. I said, what do you think God's leading you to do? Man, I just don't know. And some of us in this room have probably sat in that very seat, and we wondered, what in the world? I don't know where I'm headed. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know what God is calling me to do. But he is calling every one of us to live a life in his will. So what does his will look like? What does God's will look like? How do we know what the Father is really asking of us? As we look at this particular passage found in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, it actually kind of begins earlier than that. It began back in verse 13 of Matthew chapter 7. And you're welcome to follow along. This is what this says. Jesus says this. He says, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction. And there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. That's out of the New King James Version. But I had them put the Message paraphrase on the screen because I love the way that it reads. Don't look for shortcuts to God. You might say, amen or ouch. The market is flooded with surefire, easygoing formulas for a successful life that can be practiced in your spare time. Don't fall for that stuff, even though crowds of people do. The way to life, to God, is vigorous and requires total attention. I like the way that that reads. I will never forget the time that my son, Drew, he had just gotten his driver's license. And, you know, that's always an exciting time for those of you, and some of you here probably have just gotten your license. He had just gotten his license, and so he got his car. He got a cool Acura, red, tinted windows, nice rims. It was a neat car. Of course, it was kind of a fast car, too. And anyway, he was coming out of the parking lot at the high school one day, and he didn't see someone and messed up his car. He had an accident. First I want to know whose fault it was. And then when I found out it was his fault, boy, he was in so much trouble. We got the car home, and I said to him, I said, Drew, I mean, you know, when stuff like that happens, you have to figure out if you're going to sell the car or you're going to get a new car or how you're going to get it fixed, all this. You know, I was trying to teach him, you know, a little responsibility. And he said, well, I think I'll try to raise the money. And so I said, well, I'll help you put your car back together. If you want to do that, we'll buy the parts. So he raises the money. We buy the parts. We had to put a new hood on it and a new bumper on the car. As many of you know me, know that I am not really mechanically inclined, and even a cosmetics type stuff like this on vehicles is not my forte. So I got out there one day. I was determined I'm going to get this done. You know, we got the hood on, but it just quite wasn't fitting right. Then I started working on the bumper. And I, you know, when it's hot and things don't seem to cooperate very well, and you know, sometimes a little bit of a temper flare up, you know, comes up. And so that was happening to me. I was getting really frustrated. So I said, you know what? I'm going to fix this. Duct tape fixes everything. And you know what? I'm going to even go a step further. Not gray like the traditional duct tape. I'm going to get red duct tape to match the color so nobody will even know. I mean, I thought it was a pretty great idea. Kind of cutting corners a little bit, but you know. So I got, you know, about 5 rolls of that red duct tape, and I'm out there working on that car, getting frustrated, but I'm thinking this is a great idea. Man, I'm glad I thought about this. Until Rebecca pulled up. She gets out of the car and she goes, "What are you doing?" I said, "Well, I'm fixing the car." "What, duct tape?" I said, "Yeah, that's how, you know, duct tape fixes everything." "No, it doesn't." And so I said, "Well, then you do it." And I walked into the house. Well, she got out. She started working on it. She did a great job of fixing that thing. And she had to use a few zip ties. But you couldn't see the zip ties. I was just going to tape it all on, you know. We can't take shortcuts when it comes to Jesus. Jesus says, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." There are no shortcuts. There are no easy ways around. If you play golf, you don't get a mulligan, okay? There are no shortcuts. We must go through Jesus. Jesus is the way. And it's important for us to remember that. Jesus also stated that we would, in his word, he said, you would be known by the kind of fruit that you produce. The kind of things that come from you, the kind of things that happen as a result of your involvement, the kind of things that you're plugged into, they'll produce some kind of fruit. People will know you by that. I've shared with a friend of mine, you earn your reputation. You earn your reputation. What kind of reputation have you been earning all your life? Are you a person of your word? Do you do things, and when you say you're going to do them, you follow through? Are you a person who doesn't? You earn your reputation. Romans chapter 10, verse 19 says, "For they speaking," this is speaking of the Israelites, and this is interesting, "being ignorant of God's righteousness, and seeking," this is the problem, "seeking to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted to the righteousness of God. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus," and unfortunately, some people just in there, we just confess that Jesus is Lord. We'll just confess that. But there's more. Not just confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and you believe, the scripture says, believe in your heart. Everybody say believe. We have to believe in our heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. Do you believe? It's important, ladies and gentlemen, as followers of Jesus, to remember that we cannot take a shortcut in our faith. We must believe in our heart, confess with our mouth, believe in our heart that Jesus was raised from the dead. A disciple, a follower of Jesus, chooses to live in the will of God. We find, how do we find to live in the, what it means to live in the will of God? Do you think taking advantage of somebody else for your own gain is living in the will of God? Do you think stealing from someone else is living in the will of God? Is it possible to live in God's will? I believe so, with the help of the Holy Spirit. You see, a lot of times we try to live in the will of God in our own ability and in our own strength. And rather than trusting in the Holy Spirit and allowing Him to fill us up to overflowing and help us through the hard times, and believe me, as a Christian, things get tough. In fact, there are times when we go, man, I don't want to be nice to that person. I don't like them very much. I don't care about them. I'm going to go a different way. And Jesus says, hold on a minute. Love your neighbors. Pray for those who persecute. Love your enemies. And we're like, man, I don't know, Jesus. Really? Do I really have to do that? I mean, are you sure? You know, we'd like to just kind of, sometimes, we'd like to take the easy route or the more comfortable place. We'd like to be a little bit more comfortable. You know, just get me my lazy boy chair. In fact, let's just get one for the platform. I'll just kick my feet back and we'll talk about Jesus. I don't think that would fly around here. He's challenging to us. You see, it's important for us as followers of Him to be authentic. People don't like it when they feel as if you are a fake or not sincere. The authenticity of a follower of Jesus is determined by their relationship with Him, not by their resume or list of the great things that they've done. I've done this, 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 and this. It's more about who you know and not as much about what you know. We must not forget that not everyone who says they are a Christian is a Christian or a follower of Jesus. There has never been a point in time in Christian history where everyone who professed Christ was a follower of Him. Even among, hear this, even among the 12 disciples. Yeah, remember Judas that betrayed Jesus? It's always been the case. A.W. Tozer said this, "The Bible recognizes no faith that does not lead to obedience, nor does it recognize any obedience that does not spring from faith." You see, the two are opposite sides of the same coin, and they are necessary to be together and in the right order. Faith and obedience are necessary for salvation. One is a proof of the other. Obedience to God does not earn you a ticket to heaven or saved status. But a faith and trust in God will, without exception, lead to obedience. Do you believe? If you say that you are a child of God and there has been no transformation, then maybe you're not even saved. A saving faith will always lead to obedience and transformation. This kind of a person makes it the habit of their life to follow after God. Is there action to my faith? You might ask yourself that question, because Jesus stretches us. Man, I tell you what, if you've never been on a mission trip, it might be time to start thinking about it. You might go, well, I can't do that. Oh, you can't or you won't. Oh, you know, you maybe need to reach out to that coworker who's really struggling at work. Oh, I can't do that. You can't or you won't. Or that person down in the grocery store that I saw, I've seen them several times. That's the same cashier. I probably need to reach out. You can't or you won't. You see, Jesus sometimes makes us very uncomfortable. I don't get real excited about having to go and apologize for something that I did wrong. It's not the most enjoyable thing for me. I don't get all thrilled and get butterflies in my stomach because I want to say I'm sorry and I was wrong. I don't like that. None of us probably here in this room like that. But sometimes it's necessary when Jesus begins to speak to us and says, listen, Nate, you were out of line. And you need to apologize for that. And you need to say that you were sorry. Do I say, but Jesus, I have a better idea? He's going to say, okay, you go do whatever you really want to do. Because he's not going to force us. He loves us and he cares about us. And he has our best interest in mind. The one who created us knows our innermost thoughts. The Bible tells us that there will be a day when our Lord Jesus will come again. And he's going to take us home. He's going to come and he's going to come to take us home. And every one of us will have to give an account with what we've done, with what God has given us. All the resources that he's given us to steward, all the relationships that he's placed in our lives, we're going to have to give an account to God someday for the way that we handled the things that he's placed in our path. We're going to have to be ready to say, okay, Lord, this is where I'm at. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20 through 21, it's on the screen there. It says, for the kingdom of God is not just a lot of talk. It's living by God's power. Which do you choose? Should I come with a rod to punish you, or should I come with love and a gentle spirit? The Apostle Paul wrote that. What a man who was wise beyond us. He had so many great insights and wrote much of the New Testament. And here he says, it's not just a lot of talk. It is living by God's power. Do you think Paul experienced living in the power of God? I believe so. And I believe that you and I can live in the power of God. But are we? Do we know? Is his power evident in the way that we have chosen to live? Can we point back to that and go, that was God. That was not me. That was God doing that. Or do we go, no, I got this. I got this. I'll take care of it. A follower of Jesus chooses to live in the will of God. Not only that, but a follower of Jesus chooses to lift up the name of Jesus. A follower of Jesus chooses to lift up the name of Jesus. Let's go ahead and go to that next slide there. Paul wrote to the Philippians in chapter 2, verse 5 through 11 of the New Living Translation, he said this, you must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had, though he was God. I love this. Jesus didn't just come and say, hey, I am the Son of God, you can't touch me. He didn't. That wasn't his attitude. Jesus came, and he had a certain kind of demeanor. It says, though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on a cross. Therefore, because of his attitude, God elevated him to a place of highest honor, gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. There's an old praise song that we used to sing when I was first learning guitar. There's only two chords, I think it was. and it was E minor and D, I think. And those two chord songs are great for beginner guitar players. And so I just play that over and over again. It was a song, Humble Yourself in the Sight of the Lord. And then there was a repeat, Humble Yourself. And He will lift you up higher and higher, and He will lift you up. You see, he lifts up those who humble themselves. That's kind of an opposite thought, isn't it? We want to lift up ourselves sometimes, make ourselves look good. But that's not the following Jesus way. That's the world's way of doing things. So we need to humble ourselves. That was the heart and heartbeat of Jesus. That was the heartbeat of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And when we lift up His name, the name that is above all names, He gets the attention that He deserves. He gets the attention He deserves. He deserves our attention, and He deserves our devotion. Jesus says in John chapter 12, in the Gospel of John chapter 12, verse 32 of the New Living Translation, He says, "When I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw everyone to Myself." There's something about Him, about Jesus, that people are truly drawn to. You see, He's genuine, He's sincere, He's honest, He's frank, He knows best about what we need. And we have to ask ourselves as we consider all this, what are we choosing to lift up really in our life? And are we really lifting up Jesus? You see, while He was on the earth, people would follow Him. They'd follow Him out into the wilderness. They would follow Him. He would get into a boat to go across the sea, and they would find a way to get over to Him. They wanted to be with Him, but that doesn't mean that they were all followers of Jesus. Let's remember, though, that not everyone who followed Him had good intentions or motives. Not everyone who followed Him even liked Him. Some of them were looking for ways to trap Him, and at the end, there were the religious leaders who brought up false accusations against Jesus and took Him to the cross. Why do I bring this up, that not everyone liked Him that followed Him? Well, because what Jesus taught was not easy for anyone to accept. It went against the grain of our natural humanity. At one point in time, there were many disciples who left Jesus because His teaching was so hard. There was a mass exodus of disciples because His teaching. They said, teaching, this is a hard teaching. Does what He says to do, we just got done studying the Beatitudes, and there are so many challenges in that. Did some of those I hope they made you feel uncomfortable. I hope they made you think, I need to do things maybe differently than the way I feel. Go against the grain. A follower of Jesus chooses to lift up the name of Jesus. Lastly, a follower of Jesus chooses to let go of their rights, their selfishness. Anything that they are tempted to place before Jesus. From the Old Testament to the New Testament, God has said we cannot have any other gods before Him. He must be first. In the Word of God that was read earlier, the passage of Scripture found in Matthew chapter 8, verse 18 through 22 says this. It talks about two different people who said, "I'll follow You. I'll follow You, Jesus." It mentions the scribe, and the scribe wrote down the important things that the author wanted others to remember. And most often, scribes were religious people. And it also mentions another of His disciples. And the H is capitalized, saying that's another one of Jesus' disciples who said, "I will follow You." And this is a follower of Jesus. Out of that passage of Scripture that was read, I think it's, did I put it up on that screen? Is that passage on? No. Okay, go ahead and go back. I was hoping that I would. Matthew chapter 8, verse 18 through 22. You can look at that passage. But Jesus' response, that's what I want to talk about. His response to both of them gives us a little bit of insight. And He implies there may be times when you don't even know where you can lay your head down at night. Are you ready to make that kind of a commitment? There may be times you don't know what's around the corner. Are you ready to be committed even if you don't know all the answers? There's going to be a lot of unknowns in the world. Do you trust that God knows best? Have you been in His Word? You know, I got to be honest with you, there are many times as I think about Rebecca and I's life in ministry. I remember when our kids were little and when they were born and they were growing up, and we were so grateful for the church. The church became our family many times because we didn't get the privilege of living close to mom and dad and being able to be nearby, and so they became our family. The church loved us. They cared for us. They treated us better than we deserved. And that's the same way it is here. You all treat us very, very kindly. And we are so appreciative and so grateful for that. But I will tell you that everywhere we've been, that it wasn't what we anticipated that it would be. Everywhere we've served, there were other nuances that we weren't aware of when we got there. One church that we went to serve, I found out they'd been through like 6 or 7 splits. And I found that out, of course, not before I got there. After I got there, I found out that there were more people who used to go to our church than actually went to our church. I'd run into them in the community, and that church. I used to go to that church. I used to attend there. And that would hurt my heart, but I would think to myself, well, there's a great group of people still there. And they loved us, and they cared for us. And I'll tell you, we had a wonderful time of serving there. And God continued to speak to us and help us and encourage us. And that's what God does, isn't it? Things might not be what we anticipate them and what we hope there to be. But God has a way of carrying us through things in ways that blew our mind. And I'll tell you, everywhere we went, it wasn't what we anticipated. It was that much better. It was that much better. You see, God has a purpose and a plan for every one of us. And sometimes when things don't look so exciting and they look kind of gloomy and they look kind of difficult and we begin to struggle and we begin to just pull our hair and go, wow, God, what am I going to do? God just has to simply remind us, I have called you. You are here for me. You're not here for anyone else. I have called you. I have called you to be the kind of person that I have called you to be. And sometimes that means that we have to get out of our comfort zones. As a follower of Jesus, we must make him our first priority. The second response that he had to the one that was his disciple was, he said, you may think that there are basically other things more important than me, but you need to make me your first top priority. And sometimes we just need someone to say, you know what, just get committed to Jesus. Just show up. Be there. Make the effort. Don't take the easy road. You know how many days that I went to school sick? I'd be like, Mom, I'm not feeling so good. Can I just stay home? No. Oh, Mom, my sinuses are killing me. You know, I'm blowing my nose. I got this massive sinus headache. I just don't think I can make it. You're going. You're going to school. I don't feel like it. You're going. Really? Yes. Sometimes we just need to go, you know what? I'm going to make Jesus my priority. Everything else can take second place. Oh, I don't feel like doing it. Well, I'm going to make him my priority. We make that decision. Have you made knowing Jesus the first or top priority in your life? In Luke chapter 6, verse 6, Jesus says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do the things which I say? You see, there's a difference between what we say and what we do, and people are watching to see if we really are who we call ourselves. James 1:22 says, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. In other words, walk your talk. Jesus spoke a parable to the Pharisees in Matthew 21, verse 28. I want to read it really quickly. Matthew 21, 28. It says this, "But what do you think? A man had two sons, and he came to the first and said, 'Son, go work today in my vineyard.' And he answered and said, 'I will not.' But afterward he regretted it and went. Then he came to the second and said likewise. And he answered and said, 'I'll go.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said to him, 'The first.' And Jesus said to them, 'Assuredly I say to you that tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but tax collectors and harlots believed him. And when you saw it, you did not afterward relent and believe him.'" I don't want to be guilty of saying I'm okay and not repenting. Repentance leads to salvation. First John chapter 3, verse 18 says, "My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but in deed and truth." It's fascinating that many will say to the Lord on the day that they are required to give an account, "Look at what we did." They're being more focused on doing than on being, on fulfilling a list of the do's and the don'ts, than on being a child of the King. We need to be asking, how can I be more like Jesus in my workplace? How can I be more like Jesus in my home? How can I be more like Jesus when I'm out with my friends? How can I be more like him? You see, it's the temptation of every believer to look at what we did instead of pursuing an identity within Christ. To mark off a list of do's and don'ts instead of just sitting at the feet of Jesus and spending time with him. We've got to remember that not one of us can fool God. He already knows all about us. I like what Kyle Eidelman had to say on that testimony. He grew up in the church. I can identify with that. I'm doing religious things, but not really following Jesus the way that he has called us to follow him. And so there were a lot of things in my life that, I mean, I thought, hey, you know, I go to church. I do all these things. I dress, well, according to the kids, I didn't quite dress the part of a disciple. But I dress nice. I work. I'm a hardworking person. I respect my elders. I went down my list. But, ladies and gentlemen, it's not about the checklist. It's about loving Jesus. We can call ourselves a follower of Jesus and act quite the opposite. And if we refuse to allow him to change us, that's not his fault. We can't blame him for our stubbornness. Well, we can. It's not right, but we can. It's our own fault when we do that. Take a look at Titus chapter 1, verse 15 through 16. This is what it says. "Everything is pure to those whose hearts are pure, but nothing is pure to those who are corrupt and unbelieving, because their minds and consciences are corrupted. Such people claim they know God, but they deny him by the way they live. They are detestable and disobedient, worthless of doing anything good." Jesus once said, "If a man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." If what is on the inside of us isn't matching what is on the outside, and we are sounding like a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal, in other words, if our walk and talk don't really match, it doesn't really mean a thing to anyone, especially to God, who knows every fiber of our being. Matthew Henry wrote in his commentary, "Grace and love are a more excellent way than removing mountains or speaking with tongues of men and of angels. Grace will bring a man to heaven without working miracles, but working miracles will never bring a man to heaven without grace." Let's not forget that we must love Jesus. We must make him first in our lives. If we love him, we'll obey his commandments. He doesn't say this. He doesn't say if we obey the commandments, then we will obviously love him. He says if we love him, we will obey his commandments. God desires our obedience, but he only desires it if it comes out of an affection for him. Obedience doesn't start from affection for him is self-worship, and we can very easily become self-righteous people if we're not putting our affections to Jesus. And we don't want that, do we? We don't want to become so full of ourselves. We want to, less of us. We want to say with John, less of us. Lord, that you may increase that in our lives, that we may decrease. Less of us. More of you. It's not about getting what I want. It's about getting what he wants. What does he want? Followers of Jesus, follow Jesus. He said, "I am the way, truth, and life. No one comes to the Father except through me." And we have to do things on his terms, in his way, not our own. Well, in a moment, we're going to share in the Lord's Supper in what we call communion. And I want to ask you those questions there on the screen. Am I a follower of Jesus? You want to ask yourself, do I choose to live in the will of God? Sometimes that's rough. Sometimes we fight ourselves. But is Jesus more important, and is his what he thinks more important than what you think? Do I choose to lift him up his name? Do I choose to let go of my rights and my selfishness? I will tell you that most of the time, if Rebecca and I, we do argue, and most of the times that we get in the biggest arguments are Sunday mornings. We're getting ready, or something's going on. Saturday nights, right before Sunday morning, we get, you know, and I don't want you to think that we fight all the time. We don't. But you know, that number three, do I choose to let go of my rights? Is not easy sometimes. And sometimes it's necessary to say, God, it's not about me and what I want. It's about you and what you want. And I want to encourage you this morning to ask yourself, challenge yourself, am I really one who follows Jesus or am I not? And reflect on those things. Well, we're going to go ahead and shift gears here for a moment and share in communion. And this is a special time for us to do this, a time for us to share in the Lord's Supper. And the Lord's Supper, or communion as we know it, is a special time for us to be able to reflect on the incredible sacrifice that Jesus made on our behalf. And we can be sitting here today having a personal relationship with God, being a part of the family of God because of what Jesus did. And the scripture instructs us to take communion to remember of the things that God has done. So let me read what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 29. He says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes.'" Jesus is coming again. Let's remember that. We proclaim his death until he comes. Jesus is all we need. Let's remember that. God ordained this sacrament, and he commanded his disciples to take the bread and wine as a symbol of his broken body and his shed blood. And so this is his table. And the symbolism shown here is for his followers, his disciples. So if you've repented of your sin, accepted salvation, accepted Jesus as your Savior, you can participate in taking these emblems. And let's never forget the reason why he came to earth, died on the cross, and rose again from the grave. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, as we come before you this morning, we remember the incredible sacrifice that we've read about, we've heard about, preached about, that has spoken to our hearts. We remember coming to know you, and we thank you for making that possible. We receive the bread and the wine according to what your word has said to us. We ask that you would help us, that in your incredible passion for all mankind and the death price that you paid on the cross, that we remain grateful for the love that you have shown and continue to show. As we take part in this very holy sacrament, we are grateful for that love that you show to each one of us, and we ask that you'd bless this time as we share it together. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's not forget that the same night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and he gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and then he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." At this time, we ask that you prepare your heart. And when you're ready to take communion, that you would stand and come and do so. And I'd like to ask that you would allow our praise team to lead the way first. And when you're ready, come and take of communion. Follow as after the praise team is taken. We ask that you'd come and follow, and then we'll close in prayer after everyone has been served.
Set free, my God, my Savior, ransom me like a flood. His mercy reigns, unending love. is good to me. His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, my chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Let's close in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we can come and be in your house today. God, help us to be followers of you, not fans. God, help us to make decisions every day that follow you. Ask what you want in our lives. God, help us to be less like us and more like you. God, keep us safe and bring us back next week so we can worship you again. It's all about you. We love you and pray this in your precious and holy name. Amen. You are dismissed.